Okay, so this short video will be about how we thermoregulate or maintain a constant body temperature, which we call thermoregulation. So when we look at humans, our body temperature, its set point is 37 degrees Celsius or 98.6 degrees Fahrenheit. So what we're going to see is what happens when our body temperature rises above this or drops below. How do we return it back to set point at 37 degrees Celsius? So let's pretend that you're out exercising in the heat, you're generating heat on the inside, the sun is shining on you, and your body temperature rises. Or maybe you just have a whole lot of layers of jackets on you, so then you get hot, right? So once your body temperature rises, your brain will actually receive those signals, those electrical impulses from your sensory neurons will send a message to your brain, and then your brain will coordinate how your body will respond. So there's two responses that we're going to talk about. One is when your nervous system sends a message to your sweat glands to begin to sweat. Now, sweating is part of evaporative cooling. When the water evaporates off the surface of your skin, the idea is that it will take some of the heat with it, therefore cooling you off. That's why, like on a humid day, when you're hot and you're sweating, you don't really feel like you're getting cooler because there's already so much moisture in the air. Your sweat isn't evaporating, and therefore you're not cooling down. Now, the other thing that happens is our blood vessels will actually dilate. So if our blood vessel diameter is normally like this, it actually gets bigger, and we call this vasodilation. So our blood vessels, like I know when I run, I used to run cross country when I was in high school, and after a run, my whole face would be so red. And that's because my blood vessels right below the surface will actually vasodilate and get closer to the surface of my skin. So that way, when my sweat evaporates, then some of the heat in my blood will then also be like lifted off or evaporate away, be like radiated off of me. And so both of those reactions in your body are going to work to try and bring you back to homeostasis. So sweating combined with vasodilation cool the body back down to 37 degrees Celsius. Now, when your body can't cool down though, that's when you have conditions like heat stroke or something where your body remains too hot for too long. Okay, now what happens though? Oh, we're back to set point. What happens if your body temperature drops? So if you're outside and it's super windy, you're walking to school and you don't have a jacket, right? The wind is like, it's a cold wind and it's taking your body heat and your body temperature is dropping. Or maybe you just forgot a jacket that day, or you're stuck in the snow and your jacket's not thick enough. Whatever the reason may be, if your body temperature starts to drop, there's a couple reactions that are going to happen. Again, the messages about the cold temperature is being sent to your brain through your nervous system. Then your brain is going to communicate with your muscle cells. So it's going to send messages through motor neurons to your muscle cells, telling them to shiver or basically like create a lot of friction. So when your muscle cells are shivering, two things are generating the heat. One is if you like rub your hands together, you can feel warmth. So when your muscles rub together, that also can create heat. But your muscles contracting requires energy or ATP. And when you actually produce ATP from your food, that reaction releases heat. So the making of ATP is also a heat-releasing reaction. And then the other thing that happens, it's the opposite of your blood vessels dilating. Instead, they constrict and they get move away from the surface of your skin. You can think about it as they kind of like move deeper into your body, away from the skin. It's not really totally accurate, but at least there, the cold surface, the cold air, isn't taking or stealing the heat from your blood. This is very simplified. And then both of these reactions, though, will bring you, hopefully, warm you back up to 37 degrees Celsius and put you back into homeostasis. But real fast, a couple fun facts about thermoregulation. So one of them is that as a warm-blooded endotherm, we are endotherms or warm-blooded organisms. We actually use the food that we eat, our calories, as we break our food down in our mitochondria, that generates the heat that we use to keep us at 98.6 degrees. So if I find like an alligator who's not warm-blooded, it's a reptile, a cold-blooded ectotherm, if I find an alligator of my same body size, I would actually require a whole lot more calories because I use my food to break it down to create the heat to keep me at 37 degrees Celsius. Where the alligator, the reptile, is going to, its body temperature will change with the environment. So it does not thermoregulate. The other thing, because we do, when we break down our food to make ATP or to make energy, those chemical reactions create heat. So on really hot days, this is why you feel lazy. This is why you feel kind of sluggish. And that's because if it's hot outside, inside your body is going to slow down energy production. Because when we make energy, we create heat. So if it's hot outside and we're creating heat on the inside, that's really difficult for our bodies to maintain at 37 degrees Celsius. So we slow down our energy production. Now, if you've ever gone to like a school dance, think about like prom or winter formal or something, and the dance floor is so hot, that's because all of the energy that's being used to dance, all of the cells making that energy is also producing a lot of heat. So so that is my little discussion on thermoregulation and how we maintain homeostasis. So great job.